Already during Dick Bucker's leadership, the entire orchestra sector was undergoing some drastic change. For an orchestra like the Metropole, that change implied that musicians and staff, together some 65 to 70 people, had maximally 3 days to prepare a new performance, which more often than not is a once or at the most a twice-off performance. This is quite different from the 50s and 60s, when there was ample time for rehearsals, as these were paid for by the public broadcasting company's budgets and were taped in a studio with or without a live audience. Whereas nowadays, if any money is to be made, it requires large stages like the Heineken Music Hall, the Concertgebouw, the RAI building in Holland, or, for instance, in the UK, the Royal Albert Hall. That is, of course, if the program is so attractive that it draws an audience that is large enough to fill these venues two or three times and that is willing to pay the ticket prices. And all that in an environment where there are many concerts and festivals where admission is free of charge and which then competes with a typical Metropole Orkest stage performance. Add to this the fact that the Metropole's contribution to both radio and TV programs of the public broadcasting corporations had ceased almost completely, and it is crystal clear that the orchestra faced considerable challenges. Vince Mendoza did not let these impediments come between him, the orchest, and the quality and quantity of its output, as may be witnessed by the many splendid moments found in recordings and concert performances like the CDs 54 with guitarist John Scofield, Revolutions with keyboardist and composer Jim Beard, Fast City, an homage to Joe Zawinul with, among others, Peter Erskine, the two CDs with Bert Bacharach songs performed by vocalist Treintje Oosterhuis, the CD with singer El Giro, the concert performances with Brazilian composer and keyboardist Ivan Lins, the El Viento and Esquivel projects, the Ellington Suite performances in the Amsterdam Concertgebouw, North Sea Jazz and Hague Jazz Festival's performances with trumpeters Terence Blanchard and John Faddis, trombonist Steve Turay, tenor saxophonist Joshua Redman, piano players Hank Jones and Kenny Barron, the Edison Jazz Galas with vocalist Diana Reeves, Richard Bona, the crossover concerts with music from the Maghreb and Caribbean, the Ivan Lins, Kurt Elling and El Giro concerts, the open-air concert for Queen Beatrix to celebrate Liberation Day, and the two Charles Mingus tribute concerts in 2009 under the guest direction of bandleader and bass player extraordinaire John Clayton. And not to forget the wonderful tribute to jazz composer Oliver Nelson and his music in 2015. To illustrate the obstacles faced by the Metropole organization, we'd like to quote Mendoza. Quote, "We need to maintain good relations with the large theaters and concert halls in the Netherlands because we need them so we can perform all these different musical genres for the audience. There is an increasing pressure to sell more tickets and in order to have an easier time of it to fill the house, so to speak, theater management want high-profile guest artists, and that makes it more difficult for us to develop young talent in bringing them together with the orchestra, and in addition to that, develop new, innovative, unique musical ideas and concepts. But whatever happens, the orchestra should always keep rehearsing." Unquote. When Jules Buckley took over the chief conductorship from Vince Mendoza in 2013, he had faced some of the darkest days of the Metropole Orkest. On December 18, 2012, Jules led a musical last chance performance for and in front of the members of the Dutch parliament who were going to ratify a proposal by one of the government coalition partners to take away the financial subsidy which allowed the orchestra to operate and become the world's leading pop and jazz orchestra. A position that was and still is unique in the worldwide entertainment sector. Did Dick Bakker lead the orchestra in the 90s and the first 5 years of this millennium to a leading position in Europe, Vince Mendoza brought it even wider international fame due to his fantastic compositions and arrangements and his very extensive network in North America, which led, as stated before, to a multitude of CDs in which the Metropole Orchestra performed with many US top soloists. It was clear that the decision to be taken by Parliament would clearly endanger the survival of the orchestra. A petition signed by some 35,000 people, a mini CD with the tune Worldwide Orchestra, which featured the orchestra and a host of Dutch star vocalists, that became an instant number one in the Dutch pop charts, and that last chance performance conducted by Jules Buckley in the Parliament building ultimately led the coalition government to decrease the subsidy cut by 50% to 3.5 million euros, which again was cut this time to 3 million effective January 1st, 2017. So not an entire orchestra was saved, but only 2/5 of an orchestra. The orchestra's management then decided to keep the current personnel, absolutely necessary if quality level and unique position were to be maintained, and instead cut work time and salaries by 50%. In spite of all this turmoil, Jules Buckley succeeded in leading the orchestra to a series of incredible highlights, which opened up new and innovative musical avenues, thereby simultaneously increasing the orchestra's appeal to a younger audience. To name a few, a Grammy Award for its cooperation with the New York band Snarky Puppy, resulting in a CD and DVD entitled Silva, recording a CD with new star singer Laura Mvula in the London Abbey Road studios of Beatle fame, concert performances in Germany with Lala Hathaway, Gregory Porter and Kurt Elling, an absolutely stunning studio concert with the new star jazz vocalist Cecile McLaurin-Salvant, a concert appearance at the Amsterdam dance event with composer DJ Henrik Schwartz, and a night at the Proms in the Royal Albert Hall in London, celebrating the music of Quincy Jones, featuring Quincy himself and young budding stars Jacob Collier, Corey Henry, Alfredo Rodriguez and Richard Bona. And Jules Buckley has many more plans for further musical adventures that will again open up new horizons for the world's leading symphonic pop and jazz orchestra. The Metropole Orkest heads into its eighth decade with confidence.